Hi, I'm John Keenan, State Senator representing Norfolk and Plymouth District. I want to thank you for joining me of this episode of Bringing Beacon Hill to You. What I'd like to talk about today is just to give a brief overview of the fiscal 2016 state budget process and the state budget in and of itself. The overview will be just that. We'll go through a few slides and bear with me. It's my first time doing it in this format, so we hope we get it right. But again, thank you for joining us. You know, the budget process really begins early in the preceding year. Really, after we pass a budget, the work starts then on preparing for the next year's budget. So in July, August, September, and October, the governor's office starts their process of preparing for the budget. They reach out to all the departments, all the commissions, and get the information that they need to put together the governor's version of the budget. Once that is done, and it takes several months, they prepare for submission to the legislature. But one of the things that they work on first is coming up with what they call an established or consensus revenue figure. And once that's done, then the budget is informed to be submitted to the legislature. So really the process starts with the governor's budget, and we'll go to the slide that will show that. It shows the budget process going through. The budget from the governor comes in usually in February or thereabouts. And then it is reviewed by the legislature, by the House and the Senate. And they get the sense from the governor's budget, what the governor's priorities are, where the governor maybe wants to go with spending in certain departments and what his priorities may be. So when that budget is submitted, it's reviewed, it's analyzed, and then the House and the Senate get to work on preparing their own budgets. And they go through a similar process, having agreed on revenue, of reaching out to departments and getting a sense of what may be needed. So the House Ways and Means Committee is tasked with that. They file their budget in mid-April. That has been filed. The House then debates its budget. Representatives file amendments. They go to the floor. They debate the budget. They arrive at a final budget. The Senate then follows, and the Senate budget is done usually in about the middle of May. Same thing. Budget amendments are filed once the Senate Ways and Means Committee releases its budget. And after that process, you then have a House version of the state budget and a Senate version of the state budget. The House and Senate, they meet in what's called a conference committee, and they iron out any differences that may exist. Once those differences are ironed out, the budget is then presented back to the House, back to the Senate, and it's an up or down vote at that point, meaning a representative or a senator, depending what branch the budget is in at the particular point, can't make any amendments. They just have to vote yes or no on the budget that came out of the conference committee. Once the Senate and House have voted on the conference committee budget, it then is sent off to the governor. And the governor can sign it as is, the governor can do some vetoes, the governor can send it back with some messages, and ultimately the goal is to have a budget in place by the end of June so that the funding will be there for July 1st, which is the beginning of the fiscal year. So the fiscal 2016 budget will be passed hopefully by the end of June of 2015, will take effect July 1st of 2015 and run through June 30th of 2016. The current fiscal picture for the state overall is pretty good. This budget, for the first time in several years, does not rely on any funding from the stabilization account. It does rely on one-time revenues, approximately $616.3 million in one-time revenues. And those revenues, part of that comes from what would have otherwise been transferred into the stabilization account, the rainy day account, will instead be made available for the upcoming fiscal year budget. There are a couple other one-time revenues, some, for instance, from the sale of a courthouse. But those one-time revenues account for about $616 million, and that is a great move forward by the Commonwealth not to have to rely on a draw from the stabilization fund. Again, it's the first time in several years that we haven't had to do that. Now, going back to what I mentioned earlier about the revenue picture, there is a process where the state determines how much money we'll have available for the upcoming fiscal year. The Ways and Means Committee hold a revenue hearing, and they determine, based on presentations from economists and others, what's happening in the economy, what's likely to occur relative to different taxes. For instance, the meal tax, which makes up about $986 million of revenue. The economists will give a general sense of what's going to happen in that segment of the economy and how much the state may be able to realize through the meals tax that would be available for the state budget. Same thing with motor vehicles taxes, the sale of motor vehicles. How's the economy doing? What can we expect going forward? And what will be the tax revenue generated as a result of motor vehicle sales? So the slide that's up on the screen now shows you what's there for revenues for the Commonwealth. So you'll see that the income tax is the highest, that's at about $14 billion. Corporate tax come in at about $2 billion. You'll notice that cigarette sales tax comes in at about $513 million. There's an issue going on with sales tax on cigarettes because there's a lot of cigarettes that are being pirated into the Commonwealth and sales tax is not being collected on those. That's something that the legislature and the governor are trying to address. You'll see that there's a regular sales tax, a little bit over $4 billion, motor fuels tax. So that's generally the revenue that is available to the Commonwealth. There are also other sources that come into play, which we can touch on a little bit later. So once the revenue figure is established, the budget established, into the budget session we go. So once you've established your revenues, that's what you have to work with, because the Commonwealth has a balanced budget requirement. Unlike the federal government, here in Massachusetts, we have to balance the budget every year. And so you take your revenues, and then you determine what your priorities are, and you match spending to those revenues. So the next slide will show you a little bit of what's happened with expenditures over the years. You'll see, going back to fiscal year 2001 on the slide, the dashed line, which is on the top, means that the numbers have been adjusted for inflation, and the solid line, which you'll see going up, shows you what happens when there's no inflation adjustment. So focus on the solid line. That's what's happened with state budget spending since fiscal year 2001. It has increased even when we had some difficulties in 2008 and 2009. You'll see that it leveled off, but that there has been over the years a steady increase in state spending. What the top line shows is that when you adjust that spending for inflation, meaning, you know, what you paid for this year is going to cost you a little bit more next year, even though you're spending a little more on the budget, you're maybe not hitting that target. So when you see that adjusted, you can see that state spending, when adjusted for inflation, has been fairly flat. Now, it's interesting when you look at the next slide, which is a slide that shows a pie chart of expenditures, you'll see that the biggest expenditure by far in the state government is health care. And then after that, it is education, and health care and education account for about 65% of the budget. You'll see the health care comes in at just under 45%. You see that education's just over 18% of spending. And when you factor in human services spending at about 9.8%, you can see that a good portion of the state budget is consumed, the spending is consumed by three major areas. You'll see that law and public safety come in at about 6.35%. Local aid, which we'll touch on later, comes in at about 2.5%. Now, as far as education spending, that is money that is spent in Chapter 70 education aid, which is special education and the special education circuit breaker. There is a whole host of programs that the state spends money on relative to education. It also includes higher education. And so one of the issues that we faced this year was, would we be able to budget enough to keep tuitions and fees in our state colleges and universities flat? And it looks like that's going to be a bit of a challenge. As I speak today, the House and Senate are still in conference committee, and it remains to be seen whether they will arrive at a number that would eliminate the need for the state colleges and universities to increase fees and tuition. But nonetheless, the systems are prepared to increase. The early figures are that those fees and tuition combination may go up about $500 per year. But we work hard every year to try to keep higher education as affordable as possible. For law and public safety, the spending there generally is on the state police. We also have Shannon Grant program, where grants are given to local municipalities. In the city of Quincy, for instance, they use that for basketball programs in the summer to keep young people off the streets, keep them in a park setting playing competitive basketball. And if you go up to Fennel Courts in the summer, you'll see that there are parents and children and teenagers, really people of all ages, watching or playing in the basketball league, and it's really a great program. We also spend money, obviously, on housing and infrastructure investments. We spend money on emergency assistance for family shelters. Again, a very, very difficult public policy issue. We have a very large number of people who live in hotels That's where the state funding goes to keep them with a roof over their heads. It is not the best expenditure of state funding. It's not the best way to provide housing. And the state is looking at new ways to better house people more efficiently and in a way that is best for a family unit, for instance. We spend money on child welfare through our DCF. We spend money on programs for individuals with disabilities, whether it's housing programs, transportation programs, respite programs for care providers. So try to give you a sense of the broad range of spending in the state budget. And when I say broad range of spending, a lot of people say that's just what state government does. They just spend all kinds of money. But really, as the earlier slide has shown, spending, when adjusted for inflation, has been pretty level. What has happened is that as our revenues have increased, most of that revenue growth has been eaten up by the expenses of health care. There has been a pretty significant spike in health care spending since fiscal year 2001, as shown. And interestingly, when we looked at overall state spending, you notice when adjusted for inflation, that was relatively flat. And when you look at healthcare spending, when adjusted for inflation, it is not flat. It shows a steady increase in healthcare spending. And healthcare spending here in Massachusetts is a combination of things. It is healthcare, it is insurance for state workers, but it is also the Medicaid Mass Health Program that the state administers on behalf of the federal government. Now, it's very expensive. There are constant issues about what the state should cover through MassHealth, what it doesn't cover. There's about, I think, 1.6 million residents in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts who receive their health insurance through the state. It's expensive, as I say, but one of the things that does come into play is that a good portion of that spending is reimbursed by the federal government. So basically, the state administers the MassHealth program. It determines what coverage is available. Massachusetts is recognized as having a very thorough, complete program in place that works well for the residents. And it used to be, when people thought of MassHealth, that it was very few people who were eligible for it or people who qualified for MassHealth. And it was seen kind of as a safety net type of insurance. But really, with the Affordable Care Act in Washington, MassHealth has become, for many people, the health insurer of necessity, really. As the economy improves, we find still more people coming onto the MassHealth program because housing, health insurance, eats so much up of a middle-class budget, and they end up qualifying for MassHealth insurance. And also, we see that insurers sometimes aren't able to provide coverages for certain individuals. Maybe somebody has a chronic disease that a private employer can't afford to cover through their offered health insurance. And so a person may end up on MassHealth as a result of that. But the good news is, as I said, that a lot of that is reimbursed to the state by the federal government. The next slide will show you a little bit about what we do in education spending. And education spending, you'll see the dotted line when it's adjusted for inflation shows that education spending has suffered a little bit as a result of the increasing cost of healthcare. And that's kind of across the board. Most of our departmental budgets have seen level spending or less over the last several years, while the health insurance and the health care budget has eaten up so much of new revenue. So you see education spending from fiscal year 2001 through fiscal year 2016, as shown on the chart, really has had some slight ups and downs, but when you net it out, when adjusted for inflation, spending is below where it was in fiscal year 2001. And in real dollars, there has been an increase, but again, when you adjust it for inflation, we're not providing an awful lot more in terms of education spending compared to fiscal year 2001. The next slide, you'll see a slide of local aid. Now, local aid is money that's put forward by the state down to the local municipalities. They can use it for a whole host of things. They can use it at the local level for public safety, for education, for senior services, for library spending. There's really a lot of things that they can use the local aid that comes from the state, what they can use it for. There's Chapter 70, which is tied to education, and then there is unrestricted general government aid, UGGA, that's provided as well. So the slide that's up gives you a sense of local aid history. You can see as well that there, even when adjusted for inflation, the state has not been able to provide as much local aid to the municipalities as they had in the past. You can see the numbers showing going back to fiscal year 2001, and you can see where we're at in fiscal year 2016. Now, the good news there is that over the last 4 years, we've been able to stabilize the amount that we've been giving to cities and towns. Cities and towns like that predictability. They like to know how much they're going to get, and they like to know it as far as in advance as possible so that they can use it in the planning of their budget. So even though amounts have decreased, we've tried to get better at making local aid amounts known earlier to the municipalities and to have them be more predictable. They find, again, that that's very key to them for planning. And again, local aid can be used for a whole host of things. The next slide will show you what has happened with local aid in the communities that I represent, Abington, Braintree, Holbrook, Quincy, and Rockland. And you can see, for instance, that in most cases, local aid has gone up a little bit. The first slide shows what's happened in Chapter 70. Local aid, you'll see in Abington compared to fiscal year 15, that the spending is up slightly. The amounts being sent to Abington for Chapter 70 have increased slightly. You'll see in the slide the fiscal year 15 figure. You'll see what was proposed by the governor, what was proposed by the House in their budget, and what was proposed by the Senate. And the numbers are pretty similar. In Braintree, you will see that their Chapter 70 local aid has gone up as well. Holbrook has seen theirs go up. Quincy, same thing, has gone up. And Rockland has seen their local aid in form of Chapter 70 go up. It's done according to a formula, and there's a commission that's meeting to review that formula to make sure that it's still current. It has been in place for quite some time. Some municipalities don't think that it's fair, equitable, and so they have asked the legislature to take a look at that, and the legislature is looking at that formula to make sure that it is fair and that cities and towns are getting what is appropriate for their particular needs. The next slide is the unrestricted local aid slide, and that is money that goes to a town, again, that they can use, a city or town that they can use for most purposes. Generally, it goes into a general fund, which is the city or town's operating budget, operating fund, and then they distribute that accordingly during their budget process. Again, it may be additional funding beyond Chapter 70 for municipalities, for schools rather, within the municipalities. It may be additional spending for police, for fire, for libraries, for senior centers, for veteran services, where there has been a growing need, giving the men and women who have been coming back over the last several years from Iraq and Afghanistan. So municipalities are charged with meeting those needs. So you will see on the unrestricted local aid that compared to fiscal year 15, Abington has seen an increase, as has Braintree, going from just a little bit over $5 million to about $5.275 million. Holbrook has gone up as well. Quincy has gone up about about $610,000. And Rockland, you'll see, has gone from $2.3 million to $2.4 million. So we work hard at the legislature to make sure that we can get as much as we can back to the cities and towns, because we know that they rely on it. And that's where people really rely on services, whether it's trash pickup, whether it's getting a tree removed, planted, or pruned in front of their homes, whether it's getting potholes fixed, new books for a library, or e-books at a library, allowing for additional hours at a library, make sure the programs are being offered at senior centers, whether it's transportation programs or others. Cities and towns rely on that funding to make sure that they can provide the services. The legislature is aware of that. They work closely with the cities and towns to make sure that those numbers, again, are out there as soon as possible, and that we try to get as much local aid back as we can. So the other part of local aid that doesn't show up necessarily in the state budgeting process, but which is very important to cities and towns, is Chapter 90. That is money that's used by cities and towns for road work, essentially. They can use it for road repairs, for minor repairs of roads in some way, whether they do an overlay, or for a major reconstruction of a road. And it's the same thing. They try to get a handle on those numbers as quickly as they can so they can plan for the construction season. This year, we have appropriated $200 million in total for the cities and towns, but that's on top of $100 million that was left over from the previous year. Last fiscal year, we approved $300 million in Chapter 90 money. Governor Patrick put a freeze on about $100 million of that. When Governor Baker came into office, he released that money. So cities and towns going into this construction season have, in total, the $100 million left over from the last appropriation and $200 million additional dollars this year. In Quincy, for instance, the Chapter 90 apportionment for fiscal year 2016 will be about $2 million. That's money that's critical. That's how the neighborhood streets and sidewalks get repaired in Quincy and Braintree and Abington and Holbrook all throughout the district. And again, the key there, as it is in general local aid, is to make sure that we get those numbers and those dollars to the cities and towns as soon as possible so that they can utilize them during the construction season. An unrestricted general government aid, the Commonwealth this year will budget about $979 million that will go again in unrestricted government aid to cities and towns. It will be about $4.51 billion for Chapter 70 education aid. And the idea is to allow for a minimum increase in each one of the cities and towns or school districts of about $25 per pupil. You'll see that there's about $271 million to fully fund the special education circuit breaker, $9 million in direct grant aid to municipal libraries, about $13 million for local councils on aging, and that would allow about $9 per senior per year for innovative programs that are offered by the senior centers throughout the district. You know, I'm very fortunate in the district that I represent, we have very, very active and involved council on aging. The senior centers have become really hubs for the senior community. I was down in Rockland for the first year anniversary of the Robert J. Nyman Rockland Senior Center. They used to operate out of an old school in a room that might have been 70 or 80 years old. They're now in a state-of-the-art facility, and the attendance at the senior center has gone through the roof. The number of people taking advantage of the programs has increased dramatically. And to go down there for the first anniversary, which was very exciting because we were able to get some state funding to help with construction of that facility, but to get down there on the first anniversary and just see the excitement in the room, see how people were engaging, how active they were, how they loved their senior center, it was really great. And it's no different here in the city of Quincy where the Kennedy Center is. Mayor Koch did a great job of renovating that school and making it a modern, up-to-date senior center. The numbers show that it works. We're experiencing the same thing in the town of Braintree. We're trying to get some state funding to expand on that, to help with the expansion of that facility. Mayor Sullivan has announced he's expanding the Braintree Senior Center. We're looking to get some state funding to assist with that. So they're really just great facilities and great programs, and we're happy to try to get as much as we can to assist them. And the other thing you'll notice is about $92.3 million that is veteran spending. Massachusetts has a reputation throughout the country as being the state that does the most for its veterans. And that's something that, quite frankly, we should do. We have an obligation to do. We work very closely with the veterans community to make sure that they get services and programs. The legislature over the last two sessions has passed the Valor Act and the Valor Act II, all designed to ease the transition of active military back to civilian life and to assist those that are in active military as well, that if they get transferred from one base to another, that such things as school records will follow their children and be made readily available to the next school district. Things that seem minor, but that are very, very important to the families of those serving. And so Massachusetts has that reputation of being the best in the nation, and we'll continue to work to make sure that that is the case. One of the things that has come up quite a bit during the course of the budget debate and the preparation for the budget, and it was prompted by the situation that we had this past winter, is the reform of the MBTA. The House of Representatives passed their budget that had one component of reform within it. The State Senate took a little bit broader view of it. So those two differences are being worked out in conference committee, and they follow on the heels of the introduction by the governor of a plan to help with the management of the MBTA. The governor wanted to create a control board, basically, that would oversee the operations and the fiscal management of the MBTA. The House of Representatives did not address that in their budget. The governor had introduced a bill to address it. The Senate, in its budget, did put in place a fiscal management control board. It consists of five members, three of whom will be members of the Massachusetts Department of Transportation, including the Secretary of Transportation, who's appointed by the governor. The expectation is that the board will operate for 3 years with an option for an additional 2 years, so it would operate for up to 5 years. They'd meet at least three times a month. The meetings would be subject to the open meeting laws here in the Commonwealth. They'd make monthly reports to the Secretary of Transportation, and they would really focus on making the changes necessary to avoid future breakdowns and to put the MBTA in firm financial footing. The discussion on that, I think, will continue throughout the summer. It's our hope that we will have to the governor a comprehensive plan for the reform of the MBTA, at least the management structure of the MBTA. I strongly support a fiscal management control board with appropriate authority to address the situation at the MBTA. The district that I represent, Quincy, Braintree, Abington, Rockland, Holbrook, are so dependent upon the transportation network here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Between the Red Line, commuter rail, and the extensive network of roads, transportation is critical. And we saw no greater example of that than what we had to do when we didn't have it. The roads became clogged, the MBTA wasn't operating, the commuter rail for a long time experienced difficulties, people couldn't get to work, it had a pretty dramatic effect on the economy, it affected the ability to get children to schools, seniors to medical appointments, all people to medical appointments. It is critical, and it is something that the legislature, the governor are working on together, and I'm hopeful that we will have something in place by the end of June or as soon as possible thereafter. And the idea is to give to the governor the type of control that he is seeking to make sure that there are proper tools in place for the management of the MBTA going forward. MBTA Red Line here, you know, MBTA Red Line cars are on order. That's a good thing. They're still a few years off, but I think that will make a pretty significant difference in how transportation is delivered here in the district that I represent. So that's kind of a quick breakdown of what's been going on in the legislature relative to the budget. It is a pretty involved process. When we debated the budget, we were there most mornings at 10 a.m. We would start either in caucus or on the Senate floor, and we would continue till 10 p.m. And on the final day, we were there after midnight. There were hundreds of amendments that were filed that had to be addressed. They were. And the budget that was produced by the Senate, as was the budget that was produced by the House of Representatives, are balanced. Again, that budget is now in conference committee. The differences will be ironed out. It will be presented to both bodies, and then it will make its way to the governor's desk. The financial picture of the state overall is pretty solid. We have a stabilization account, a rainy day account, that is one of the best in the nation. Revenues for the current fiscal year, even though we had to make some mid-year adjustments from a budgetary standpoint to make sure the budget was balanced, revenue numbers do look good as we make our way through the spring and towards the end of the fiscal year. And that gives us some sense of comfort that the revenue projections we used for fiscal year 2016 should be pretty solid. A couple things that are lurking out there have to do with the number of state employees. An early retirement incentive program was passed by the legislature to trim down the number of employees. That is necessary to balance the budget. We're waiting to see what the final numbers are. I wasn't a supporter of that program. I thought it was an expensive way to balance a budget, but nonetheless, it passed. Let's be hopeful that it works and that it does play the role that it should play in balancing the budget. So that's where we're at. This is bringing Beacon Hill to you. I just thought it would be important to bring to you a sense of what's going on at the State House relative to the state budget. It is the most important thing that we do during the course of the year. It really sets the table for everything else that goes on from July 1st forward, as far as delivering those programs, making sure they're delivered efficiently, effectively, and making sure that people who need services get them, making sure that people who don't need the services aren't unnecessarily taking advantage of them. That's the work that we do throughout the course of the year, and it's great work, it's interesting work, and it's important work. So I want to thank you for joining us and giving the time to go over the budget. What will come up on the screen now is just a slide that will show you where you can receive additional information. You can receive a copy by contacting the office, my office at 617-722-1494, by sending us an email at john.keenan@masenate.gov. And we'll be happy to put you on our email list. We send out a written version of Bringing Beacon Hill to you. And we hope to make these shows pretty regular, addressing some of the topics that come up at Beacon Hill. I want to thank you for the opportunity to present the information, and I look forward to talking with you again. Have a great day.